drop that bass.
Cargo mente céu, louco. Shoot his full arms. After this, you wanna go put some grub?
Yeah.
You hungry?
Yeah.
Alright. I'm your buy for a beer.
Sounds good. I'll do funny things if you want me to.
I'm yours to have and to hold.
Darling, you got full control of your puppet.
What's up, man? What you need?
I need two.
Let me see the money. Open it up. What should you need?
High C and Caymans.
Get the hell out of here, man.
I bet. Dr. Dre in the place to be. Co-rocking shit with my homeboy Steve. At the rhodium, get stupid some. Yo, don't think that you can get none of Dre. The motherfucking doctor, the bitch hopper, the sucker motherfucking stopper. I'm fucked up, so don't mind what I'm saying. I'm just kicking it with Steve, Tony, A, and Susan. Yo, we be choosing dope shit to put in a mix. Know what I'm saying? We kick shit like and that's a fact. And if your shit ain't in a mix, you know it's whack. And that ain't no bullshit. I'm kicking facts on a serious tip. Word up, Dr. Dre's in full effect, doing serious damage, boy.
Okay, I'm gonna drop a name. Tell me the first thing that comes to your mind. Steve Yano.
Man, he was just a very special cat that I had like a lot of love and respect for, you know, once I got to know him.
Steve Yano, the king of the West Coast mixtape scene.
Brilliant.
Steve Yano, first thing that comes to mind, business, willing to help.
Intelligent, hardworking, good person.
Man, the sound of the West Coast music scene and the place where we all got our early hits.
Record scientist. Ghetto record hood scientist.
Cool motherfucker.
In the day, the Swamis were popping. That's where it all started for me. The Vermont is where I first met Steve. From there, I began to buy music from VIP Records, as well as the Compton Indoor. But at the Rhodium is where it all happened for me.
I'll share with us when and where you first met Steve Yano.
Wow. Steve Yano, Steve and Susan, wow, what a duel. What was special about Steve is how knowledgeable about, you know, not being black, you know, African-American, how knowledgeable he was about the music in general, but especially underground music. He seemed to have a special love for it and definitely played a major, major part on launching a lot of the independent recording artists' careers back in the day.
When I first met Steve, it was when Dre had moved with us. And Steve used to come bring the van, all the crates and stuff, because he used to come to my house. A lot of them Rhodium Swap Meet tapes was made at my house in the basement. And it's the same house, it's straight out of Compton house. And they, you know, straight out of Compton. And a lot of stuff happened in our house. And Steve used to come there with Dr. Dre and make all the tapes. And I'd be sitting there just kind of like, Straight Outta Compton. And that scene in Straight Outta Compton, Steve just had to be there. And it would have been the same thing.
I used to be at Audio Achievements, the studio that Dre and NWA and Easy used to work at. I was just a kid around. And I used to see him come up to the studio, and he would bring Dre records and stuff like that that he would order from, So that's when I first got a chance to meet him.
Man, I remember meeting Steve Yano with Dre for the first time. We used to always go to the Rhodium Swap Meet, like shopping for T-shirts and, stuff before we would go do shows. And there was this little spot over in the tent. And this guy named Steve Yano had his little spot selling, vinyl records and stuff like that. And we would go there and always pick up some records before we would go do shows. So Dre was like, man, you gotta meet this cat, man. He's like real, real cool. He wants me to do some stuff for him. And, so I went over there with Dre. And it had to be like 84, 85 when I first met Steve.
I met Steve Yano, man, down on Pico. I was selling Xerox, one of my first underground mixed 12 inches. We called them bootlegs back then. And because I didn't know the record business worth a damn, I knew how to make them, I knew how to produce them, and I was selling them like they was dope. Because most records have a little ring on the bottom of it. Do not copy. Copying of this product would be federal copyright. And anytime I saw the word federal at that point in time, I'm thinking FBI, okay? Even when I saw Federal Express, I got nervous, okay? How about Pico? And I walk in with my little dolly. I drop off about 150 records to Saturn Records. And Steve was in there. And I dropped off the records. Guy gave me the money. And Steve was like, hey, you guys sell these records? I act like I didn't hear a word he said. Kept on walking. I'm like, fuck you. I don't know you. An Asian dude? In the record business, I don't know the fuck. I'm out of here, okay? So George, the guy behind the counter, says, "Hey, Lonzo, he's okay, man. He has the Rhodium Swap Meet." I'm like, "Okay, I don't trust none of y'all. Ain't none of y'all black. I don't trust none of y'all, okay?" So I went by the Swap Meet, checked him out, and he was legit. I met his wife Sue, and we were cool. So I'm like, "Come on to the studio, shit, have a drink." I dog we didn't drink, so we're hanging out in the studio, the same studio we in right now. And he came out, hung out. He would hang out sometimes, And he got to meet Dre and yelling the fellas, and they invited him out to the swap meet. And that's how I met Steve. He became one of my best customers forever.
I was about 17 years old when I first heard a Rhodium mixtape. A friend from high school was actually playing the cassette on his radio. I grabbed the cassette case and it said 85 Live. I continued listening to it. I heard about three or four songs playing around the same time. I heard cutting, scratching. I heard scratching coming in. Very quickly, I'm like, how is this guy doing it? The mystery was, you're thinking that he's using four turntables, whoever's doing this. As it kept going, all of a sudden I heard Dr. Dre. The only Dr. Dre I knew was from the World Class Wrecking Crew. And then I heard the Rhodium. And then I heard Steve Yano. And I put it together. Dr. Dre was actually doing tapes for Steve Yano at the Rhodium. From that point on, I wanted to talk and catch up with my old friend Steve and find out how he knew Dr. Dre.
I would have to say it was like my senior year of high school, 1985-ish in there, 86 in there. Crazy D, who happened to be the only Mexican dude down with NWA at that time, he was also down from my neighborhood. So he'd go back and forth to mess with myself and the Cypress dudes, and then he'd go to Easy and them and do all that. And I believe it was Crazy D who brought a tape over. And of course, some 40s, D back then, toss back some 40s, play some tapes.
I first heard a Rhodium mixtape when I had the little chippers to go up and actually buy it. You know what I'm saying? I just started buying tapes. I started actually airbrushing t-shirts behind Steve's shop. Steve had the big one with maybe five or six booths, maybe 10 booths. And I had one little one with my pops behind it. And I would airbrush t-shirts, and when I would get paid at the end of the day, I'd run over before he closed and I'll buy them tapes and take them shits home, you know? And we heard about this young kid from the Harvard area named Tony A. And he was a DJ, homes, and he was going in with the big stars, you know what I'm saying? And he was like, one of us going in and infiltrating inside of all these MCs, you know what I'm saying? And his name would ring around the hood, and people were like, oh yeah, he's from Weed Monster, blah, blah, blah. You know, so we kind of felt the connection of like, man, if he's out there, we can do that shit. And I think that's when I fell in love with hip hop, man. You know what I'm saying?
The first time I heard a Rhodium mixtape, man, was that same old trip working. I was working in the corner. We were selling pants. We used to deal with all the ladies that wanted to come buy these tight pants. That's when stretch pants was like the thing. But look, man, I walked back to the bathroom and I just heard like some stuff that I kind of knew from the neighborhood that was like, man, how did they get this record? And then I heard some scratching. And back then, if you heard scratching, you heard bass, you was just like a fly on shit. You was going to just bzzz and land in that shit. I came over there and was like, man, what the hell is this? And this and that. And then I started talking. And Steve was, I think he was it 10 bucks for a tape? I can't remember. I think it was 10 bucks for a tape. And it was a cassette tape, turns the phrase mixtape. You know what I mean? Not mix CD, not mix MP3, not mix whatever. Fuck, I ain't dissing y'all shit, but y'all know what it is. Know the history of this shit.
When did I first hear a Rhodium mixtape? I first heard the Rhodium mixtape. It was 1989, January 9th. I was in Fountain Valley, California for the first time. I came out here as a kid. Before I got into music, I used to race BMX. We were in a parking lot. And I had a friend named Jesse Puentes. He was one of my partners I used to ride bikes with. And he had this big boom box in the parking lot, and we were just riding our bikes in the parking lot doing tricks. And he played this tape. And it came on, and it went,
hey, yo, Steve, you got a level?
Get busy with Easy and Tony A on the 12 Technique. See, it's a steal, and Steve is promoting them. Dope-ass tapes by the Wizard at the Rhodium. Yo, fuck it up, Tony.
I can feel it, I've overcome. I'm rocking shit at the Rhodium. Can you hear it? The taste from Steven. Rocking from the morning to the evening. Dr. Dre is here, so it's time to move. Or I'm gonna have to bitch you. Pump up the volume. You know it's legit. The Dre is still rocking shit. Can you feel it?
The difference between today's mixtapes and the Rhodium mixtapes, and not just because I did them. Let's just say that I never did not one Rhodium mixtape, and all we had was Dr. Dre's. There is absolutely no comparison today. Let's understand that hip hop started with the DJ. The mixtape started with the DJ. So today, the mixtapes, rappers have taken over that title, that name, mixtape. But it really belongs to the DJ. So really, there is no comparison. If you want to call it something else, cool. I wouldn't have anything to say about that. But to call it a mixtape, I do have a problem with that. I do, because I think you're taking somewhat of the glory away from the DJ when they came up with that name, the mixtape, which is on cassette. Your stuff is not even on cassette.
How do the mixtapes compare from back in today from then? They don't. They don't compare at all. You know, it's a lot of laziness in the bullshit of this new shit. You know, I mean, not to knock the songs on there, but the DJs behind them, you know, they don't have the, you know, DJ 101 training, you know.
No authenticity, nothing genuine. It's not even a mixtape. First of all, let's start right there. It's not even a mixtape. It's a digital mix.
Right.
And then they're not even DJs. You know, nothing to take away from the DJs today, but real DJs back then actually physically DJed and not just play with buttons and look at the camera and play with buttons and smile over here and waving at the crowd and doing this and ain't doing nothing.
I think there's a lot of good ones out there, but then there's a lot of stuff that's just slapped together, man. It's just like slapping records, what they call it. You know, it's like there's no thought to it. You know, there's no creativity anymore. But there's a couple out there that might be dope. You know, but it just needs more creativity, man. There's not enough thought into it, man. Not enough cuts and scratches and all that. Because at the end of the day, that's one of the main big things of hip hop. You know, and you don't hear that no more. So I think that's the difference these days. No creativity.
Oh, a whole lot, man. I mean, those were mixtapes. People were working to them.
people put work. I don't, you know, there were, first of all, I think they were done on a 4-track cassette. Another one thing was there were cassettes. There were really mixtapes. Mixtape. Now, I think it's just like, let me record something and just put it on Dat Piff or something. And it's my mixtape. But they don't have no kind of nothing. They didn't put no work into it. I mean, it is what it is, you know. But there was a big difference. There was a big difference. A mixtape, big difference.
The difference between the mixtapes now and the way the Rhodium mixtapes were put together was the Rhodium mixtapes were more of something that was really carefully put together. And not saying the stuff today is not, but just back in the day, to do like a Rhodium mixtape, the first 2 minutes that you're just hearing would take, you know, whether it was Dr. Dre or Tony A, it would take hours and hours, maybe even days, just for that. It was just a perfected craft, and everything just had to be absolutely right and linked together perfectly.
These mixtapes today are garbage. No imagination. I don't even know why they call them mixtapes. It's just songs.
Here's a little something about a nigga like me. They never should have let me buy a tape from Steve. Ice Cube would like to play. Don't shit mix by Dr. Dre. Since I was a youth, I like concert. Now I like the motherfucking Rhodium. Buying a tape for two, that's what the hell I do. You don't like Tony A, well fuck you.
1987 was my first Rhodium mixtape that I actually did for Steve Yonner. It featured Supersonic, which was performed by JJ Fab. That song would eventually go on double platinum. But that was actually our first song that we put on side A that I actually cut and scratched for Steve. And keep in mind, 1987, I mean, the 80s was just such a dope year. I had such a variety of songs to cut and scratch for Steve. But that was the very first song that we felt strongest coming out that year. And we featured it, and it was dope tape. 1987 was it.
The impact that the Rhodium mixtapes had on hip hop on the West Coast was crucial. We was limited for our sources. We didn't have no FM station banging it out like y'all could turn that shit on now and listen to like probably three different stations or four if you can reach out a little longer, you know. So to me, the Rhodium mixtape was so crucial because they played some of our backyard heroes, like our hometown heroes. They played Ice-T. I heard King T there. Eazy-E was like one of the first times I ever even met Eazy-E or had any like conversation or interaction with Eazy-E was at the fucking Rhodium swap meet.
Myself and J-Rock and of course the Beat Junkies and a lot of cats that grew up from that time, we were influenced what was coming out, whether it be on K-Day or on the Rhodium's mixtapes. We were definitely, some of my mixes were how I do my mixes are influenced by the Rhodium mixtapes.
The Rhodium swap meet mixtapes had a huge impact on hip hop and the hip hop culture because it was different. And, you know, wasn't nobody doing it like that. You know, you had New York, they was doing mixtapes, but you know, you had NWA who was saying whatever the fuck they wanted to say. Motherfuckers wasn't doing that shit, speaking how they wanted to speak, you know. And what that did was open up a lane for what they call gangster rap today, and it created a lot of lanes and opened up a lot of lanes for artists like myself to be able to come out. You know, I'm part of the tree. I'm a branch on the tree that Dre and Easy started. You know, and then on my branch you got Snoop, the Dog Pound, 50 Cent, Eminem, and all of those guys. You know, that's all on my branch, the Chronic. And that's what it created, man.
Because of the Rhodium mixtape, I'm sitting here today as a world famous DJ. Like I said, I've traveled the world. I've dealt with every artist you could think of. And the impact of Rhodium mixtapes, it taught you who artists was. It got you familiar with who artists were. I didn't even know who Eazy-E was. I didn't know who Tone Loc was. I didn't know who MC Ren was. I didn't know who Ice Cube was. I knew that because of that Rodeo mixtape when they were saying their name and rapping. So mixtapes introduced the world to artists, as they still do today. So, and as they've done since the beginning of time, when hip-hop started in the Bronx, in the park, and then they would record the jams in the park, and those tapes would circulate, and that's how hip-hop spread it. It comes through mixtapes. Mixtapes and DJs are the foundation of hip-hop and always will be.
Man, like, the NWA and Eazy-E music hit the Rhodium Swap Meet mixtapes first. Like, when we dropped our records, man, it was like, it was cool putting your records out, but even though people knew who Dre was and I was and Cube and Yella before, they didn't really know who Eazy was. But not until, you know, Boys in the Hood and some of that, you know, Fat Girl and LA is the Place, that stuff hit the mixtapes, man. That's what kind of put it out there for people to know, like, what is this Eazy-E? What is this NWA thing? So I think it was like a big, big push.
The impact I think it had for West Coast artists was, you know, from Mixmaster Spade, Toddy T, you know, NWA, definitely, you know, even, you know, myself, Quick, Second, Hi-C, you know, the people got to hear it just from the grassroots level before they heard it on the radio, before they saw you on TV, you know, knowing that the, you know, that you came from the Rhodium Swap Meet, and which is basically the epicenter of, you know, the birthplace of hip hop in LA. When you're going into the mainstream, you know, I should say the mainstream level. Yeah, and Steve was important to that, for sure.
Wow. The instrumentation of, or the importance of the Rhodium Swap Meet and the mixtapes in the careers of Eazy-E and NWA and Dre and Yella and a lot of other folks too, even Battle Cat, you know, was very, very high because, again, they needed an outlet, particularly when people weren't really checking for them and that sound that they were trying to create elsewhere. At the Rhodium, you had at least a way to mass market your stuff and have people listen to it and give it an opportunity and give it a chance.
I feel that the
problem.
Yo, this is your main man Steve, broadcasting live from the Rhodium. We got Hi-C and DJ Tony A in the place today, and they'll be taking calls for the next hour.
One, two, three, drop.
Not talking about a black or white thing, cause that will cause conflict and make you sit and kick. What do you do in a situation like this? Get tough or get pissed.
Up to no good with NWA the lynch mob, and we at the Rhodium as usual with my man Steve, of course, and on the motherfucking wheels of steel is my homeboy Tony A the Wizard, and we gonna kick it off something like this.
Hey, man,
tell him what your name is.
Kick it.
I'm gonna tell you right off the top what made Steve's Rhodium mixtape stand, his little store different from other stores like all the regular places that you go to. For one, he was playing the music loud. You could hear the shit. Like when you go into a store, you hear like They don't want to disturb nobody. They playing that shit all low. It might give you a little sample of that shit. Steve had that shit when you came by. He was like, God damn. You walked by like, you couldn't help but to like move. Like, what the hell is that? Oh, this some new shit. And it would make you stop.
Actually, the music he had, I mean, he had everything that the record, the real record stores and the towers and the Sam Goody's and the warehouses and stuff like that wouldn't touch or just didn't have access to. Somehow it seemed like, you know, Yano had the plug and the access to get a lot of new fresh street music as it came out.
I believe it was number one, the hospitality. You know, when you have somebody that greets you, you know what I mean? Almost on some mom and pop type approach and has a personal relationship with the artist whose records he's gonna put on the racks, you know?
He had all the independent records, including Cold Chillin', Fourth and Broadway, Tommy Boy. You couldn't really find those at the warehouse and other stores. So he also had a number of them. You know, you could buy doubles there, you know, not like a single here, a single there. So that's what made Rhodium Swap Meet great.
Back then, if you wanted to go buy the song you were listening on K-Day, it was harder. You know, you could go to Sam Goody, you can go to the warehouse, Tower Records, but you didn't really want to go to the spot. You wanted to go to the swap meet because you were going to do one run. You were going to go get a white tee. You were going to go get some boxers and socks. And you were going to go get your music right there. And if you were a DJ, you were in paradise, you know. But for us that were just buying tapes for our rides and, you know, listening to with the pad, they had the best selection, the most selection. And they just... It was street shit compared to a corporate store that didn't understand us.
Back then, we had Sam Goody's, The Warehouse, Music Plus, Tower Records, etc. You know, if you wanted to get your mainstream records, you go there. If you wanted to get your Bruce Springsteen's, your Madonna's, then you go to those record stores. But if you wanted to get an independent artist like a Mixmaster Spade, you know, if you wanted to get a King T record, if you wanted to get a Young MC, if you wanted to get a Boys in the Hood, you went to the Rhodium to get what was hot. I remember people telling me, man, I couldn't find Planet Rock anywhere else. I went to the Rhodium. Steve had doubles. Steve never ran out. And in case if he did, you can go next week and he would have it for you. Brand new box. Open it up with a razor blade, pull it out and give it to you. And they were still $3.99 for 12-inch. Albums were like $7.99, etc. I mean, that's what made Steve stand differently. Not only his hospitality, not only, you know, Susan and Carlos and Paulie and Artie working there, but it was just the whole experience that if you didn't want to buy a 12-inch record or you didn't want to buy an album, you could buy a mixtape. He'll slap open the book and you could pick whatever songs you want, all the hottest stuff, all the independent stuff, stuff that you couldn't find anywhere else. That's where you would find it. That's what made Steve stand so unique.
Being a DJ, you gotta know Steve Yano. If you didn't know Steve Yano, where do you think all the Ultimate Beats and Breaks came from? We didn't fly to New York to Downstairs Records together. We got them at the Rhodium. You wanted anything hot on vinyl, you go to the Rhodium because Steve had it. If he didn't have it, he'll have it next week for you because you, hey, I need this. All right, come back next week. The Rhodium is hip hop, and if these kids don't know about it, you get to go out there and do your research because the Rhodium is hip hop. It's always been that.
There goes that fool right there, man.
Yo, man, let me get to it.
Hey, man, what the hell took you so long, bro?
Oh, man, you know how it is out here on these streets.
Shh, have me waiting. Hold on, let me check this 20s real. All right, go ahead, man. Show them the back.
Oh, yeah. Let me get that dope beats at 24/7.
Yeah, make sure you can only give them two, man. Get the hell out of here.
Drink the juice of the kiwi, that's when you see me. Hype like Super Mario or Luigi. Keep your hop and make sure your hips and Tony A is cutting. So get a good grip in. This the funky sound that we achieving. You want a fresh pick, you better rush it to Steven. It's high seas, hell of a lyrics and beats. But I'm out of here with the in-between seats.
Hey girl, ain't no mystery.
A Rhodium mixtape is probably the best of the West. I remember hearing Bataram and, you know, the early Eazy-E. I heard a lot of Dr. Dre mixes and stuff like that. And then you would hear the mix masters on K-Day. And, you know, I guess some of them guys made the tapes too. So, you know, it was about being in the synergy of what was happening. You know, if you got a mixtape, you hear some of the good stuff, some of the new stuff, blended with the old. And it made, you know, back in the day, the Nissan truck era and all that stuff, you would hear everybody bumping the same things. You know what I mean? So if you had the tapes, you was on point. Just like kids got the downloads now, whoever gets it first. And, you know, the mixtapes was like that. Every weekend, you go in the back to see who got the new tapes coming out. So that was always the epicenter of what was going on in L.A. creatively through music.
Man, so a Rhodium mixtape is this, I call it a West Coast sound thing. Like, it was something that people on the West Coast could kind of hear what was up and coming off the West Coast. Because, you know, back in the early 80s, like 83, 84, the West Coast, it just now started getting into music, you know, like being producers and artists and DJs. So the mixtape was something that was like introducing them cats on the West Coast that was up and coming, with some old school stuff mixed in and a little sprinkle of like some of the stuff that was coming off the East Coast that we was banging in the club. So it was kind of like this thing that was, you know, kind of introducing people to the hot sound and actually telling people what to actually buy at the Rhodium swap meet at, you know, Yano's spot.
A Rhodium mixtape is sort of different than a regular mixtape at that time. A lot of the stuff from the Rhodium, when you got a mixtape from the Rhodium swap meet, and particularly from Steve Yano's booth, you would hear songs you never heard before. You know, you would hear, you know, some East Coast, you know, boom bap, or you'd hear records and mixes, special mixes of records and stuff that you had never even thought to consider before. Steve was very good at finding those gems and really finding records that were unique. And so, you know, you grab those and you'd hear, you knew when you bought a mixtape from the Rhodium swap meet, it was going to be something different and unique from the other mixtapes that you had heard.
A Rhodium mixtape is, in my perspective, a collage of creative mixing, blending, scratching, cutting, and teaching. What I mean by teaching is it's all genres of music. In the era of, like, say, hip-hop, you take every genre of music from that era and you blend it. So, for instance, 88 boom and bass was obviously everything from 88 on down that was played. So you would have records from 84 to 88 that was all collaged and mixed together. And it's just a creative masterpiece of mixing and blending and cutting and scratching. And that's basically what it is. It's nonstop. It never stops. All the way continues through the whole tape. Never stops.
A Rhodium mixtape to me is something that just symbolizes the streets, especially the Los Angeles streets, you know, the West Coast. That's like, to me, that's where it all started right there. So that, to me, anytime I hear the Rhodium mixtape, to me, that just symbolizes LA all day. And you know, it's like there's nothing but good West Coast heat came out of there, and you know that's where you went out and you got your daily dose of hip hop that you couldn't hear on the radio, you know. So that's what basically what it means to me.
If you think about it, the mixtapes, Rhodium mixtapes, were kind of a precursor to the internet YouTube, or you want to say Instagram, you know, because the mixtapes were able to were circulated all over the city. And once they your mixtape came out, a new mixtape came out, everybody was anxious to hear who's new, what's it, what are they saying, what style they have, where they from. Like artists like NWA, Dre. I'll be honest with you, when I started, we kind of emulated, we bit a little bit of the Rodian Swap mixtape on our DEA mixtape.
Man, that's a little tough, but I'll tell you what, it was the best thing ever for me, man. It was just kind of like something you never heard about. But the intro had like this crazy mix that I at the time, I believed that it was like four turntables at the same time, but I was like, how the hell are they doing this? Like, was it Superman behind the turntables or something like that? But a mixtape was a real mixtape. It was actually a cassette too, you know, just for the record.
Testing 1, 2, 1, 2. Right about now, Eazy-E and Dr. Dre's in the motherfucking house.
Times are getting crazy. It's really hard to choose it. The Rhodium's a spot to get funky, fresh music. Eazy motherfucking E and my homeboy Dr. Dre. MC Ren is in effect, and you know we don't play. The Rhodium is hitting, but you know you can't leave until you get a deaf ass tape from Steve. Oh Steve, oh Steve, oh Steve, just give me just one more tape. Oh Steve, oh Steve, oh Steve, just give me just one more tape. Oh Steve, oh Steve, oh Steve, just give me just one more tape. Oh Steve, oh Steve, oh Steve, just give me just one more tape.
Yeah, man, I came all the way down to the Rhodium Swap Meet, man, to pick up one of the NWA tapes, man. And I talked to homeboy Steve down there, man, and he said, I'm fresh out of tapes, man. How the fuck you fresh out of tapes, man? He said, because they selling like hotcakes and shit, man.
That's my man throwing down.
Hey, Paul, what's for dinner?
How were the mixtapes made? Well, that's actually a big mystery that a lot of people would always ask me. They always thought for some reason I always had four turntables. I mean, that's what I thought Dre had. But it wasn't four turntables. I would tell people that because I didn't want people to know my secret. I didn't want people to know what I was like, how I was actually making them. But it was that we were actually using a Tascam 4-track. It was a little bitty box like this. With four volumes, one master volume, and all we had was two turntables and a mixer. People think that we probably had this big studio, four turntables, a Neumark mixer. I had a Radio Shack mixer and two old Technique 1200s that I actually bought used. Steve would bring over the records. He actually taught me how to do the Rhodium mixtapes. He would tell me, this is the way Dre did it. This is the way I'm putting them together. I'm showing you, and then from there you get creative and you do it your way. And so yeah, that was the secret, a Tascam 4-track, but I would tell everybody I was using 4 turntables.
It was a great platform for us to be a part of, you know? Mm-hmm. So definitely had to say top shelf for that, because like you said, that gave us a leeway into the game.
It's almost like we did a trial run through a record label, because your mixtapes was basically like a label, man. You know, it just didn't have people signed on it, but it was propelling people to the next level, you know. It was introducing people to the street, you know. I mean, they knew Second to None in Compton, but they didn't know Second to None in Inglewood. They didn't know them in, you know, Carson, Gardena. And Gardena, all the other local areas, until, you know, they started hearing us on the Swap Meet, you know, the Rhodium Swap Meet tape, you know. And I'm just glad we was a part of that, man.
My experience during the 80s with the Rhodium and mixtapes in general, it was a great time for music to me, great time for hip hop, because you had to be a thinker, you had to be imaginative, you had to be creative. You know, now these guys, you know, everything is done for you in the computer. You know, press a button, pow, it's a mix.
You know, Steve is definitely a part of the beginning, and he was there, gave everybody a voice. And that was in the beginning. It gave everybody inspiration to want to do more. Like you, made you want to do more. Like me, made me want to do more. Like you, everybody, Ren. It goes down. The list is so long on how the Rhodium Swap Meet inspired people to be able to put music out, because people couldn't put music out there. You know what I'm saying? So if you get your little song and you put it on the Rhodium Swap Meet, it'll be all over LA.
I was in awe of
just how big of a volume that you could go and get, you know what I mean, the tapes at that time. And it was dope, man, for real. And it definitely plays a critical part of, like I said, the birth of West Coast hip hop, because so much sound was, you know, that came out of the Rhodium and different swap meets, Santa Fe Spring swap meet and stuff like that, that were actually the places, a hub where the break dancers, pop lockers, street kids, everybody would go actually to go get their tapes and stuff. And man, I remember even hearing like some of the stuff from the Rhodium mixtapes back in the day, man. And man, seeing what we were doing on our side, and it was dope, man, to be part of that, for real.
How much of an impact do I think the mixtapes had at that time? The Rhodium mixtapes, I believe, were a huge impact, and I'm gonna tell you why. There are well-known DJs, even DJs on the radio, that still talk about the Rhodium mixtape as if it was a movement, as if it was an experience, as if it was something they saw. Not only did they hear it, but it was just an experience to go to the Rhodium to buy your new mixtape, to be able to walk up to the stand and hear, you know, Dr. Dre here at the Rhodium. Yo, I'm right, Tony A. Yo, I'm High C. Yo, I'm Cube. Yo, I'm Easy. To hear all of these legends, you know, bust on a mixtape. And eventually, these guys end up blowing up, making platinum gold records, traveling worldwide. 2018, these people are still known worldwide. And where did it start? At the Rhodium. So you ask me, how much of an impact? It was a great impact. Just ask Dre. Just ask Cube. Just rest in peace, Easy. They will tell you that it was a huge impact in their career. When we didn't have radio play, you know what we had? We had the Rhodium Swap Meet mixtapes.
First name is Sir, but you can call me Jim. A quarter of a bar is what I drink. Dr. Dre's cutting just for me to make a funky tape. Just for me. Get busy. It's how I feel. You bite this tape, boy. Get real. Down the road to the Rhodium. It's time to tell you where I run. Cause CIA chilling and WA chilling. I wish you suckers, please stop killing.
It was one said, Brown Man drinking eight. Yo, Steve, please can I buy those tapes? Steve said, yo, man, I don't give a fuck. But you must up 10 motherfucking bucks. It all happened in a nigga press play. Heard Death Cuts by Dr. Dre. That's the way it goes, cause that's the shame. Steve coming up by slinging tapes. Niggas all around at the Rhodium heaven. Steve is selling by 24-7. My name is Ice Cube in the motherfucking place. Yo, Dre, kick in the...
After so many documentaries, why do you think the Rhodium mixtapes or Steve Piano have been excluded?
You know, man, Steve and the Rhodium Swap Meet and the mixtapes have been excluded because, just like Lonzo's just now getting his recognition, you know, the people who want to tell the story don't know the story. They don't know who to talk to. Most of the people I find in telling this, is trying to tell this hip hop story, are people who weren't even born yet. You know, you got people in their 30s trying to tell a story that happened 30 years ago. They hear certain parts and they won't hire a consultant. They won't hire somebody like Alonzo or somebody who really knows, or a Violent, or even a Kelvin Anderson, who knows all the players. A lot of people came from the Rhodium Swap Meet, just like people came from Crew Cut Records. People came from Kelvin Anderson. People came from VIP Records. All of us, we were the foundation of everything West Coast. Nobody seemed to care about the roots of the story. They just want to see the leaves. It's like marijuana. Nobody wants the stem. They just want the buds, okay?
You know, I often think about that too, and I wonder about that. I see it mentioned from time to time. I see it mentioned a lot from DJs from back in the day, where they mention, wow, if it wasn't for these tapes, I wouldn't have known about this artist. They really praise those tapes. I think the artists, sometimes they just don't talk about their roots and that sort of thing. And I think it's disgraceful sometimes, because that is definitely, I know for a fact, that's where a lot of these artists got their start.
You know what? I can't answer that one. I don't have an answer for that one.
I don't know why they exclude the whole Rhodium mixtape, especially from the West Coast. Steve Yano was a very key element in this West Coast movement, man.
I think it's hard because, I mean, why Steve and the Rhodium swap meet or mixtapes have been mentioned is because it's either they don't know about it or just don't want to talk about it. It's a good question.
You know, it's kind of sad that the legacy of Steve Yano and the Rhodium swap meet and his store have kind of been, you know, excluded from history. I think a lot of it has to do with, you know, it was the earliest denominator. A lot of times something that comes around so early and is so special, and a lot of people didn't have access to the Rhodium swap meet or that. It was kind of like that hidden gem. A lot of people went to the bigger, you know, record stores and stuff like that. But the real fools who know, and the dudes on the West Coast who actually got all their stuff and did stuff, actually went there. But I think that, you know, as time went on, it just was something that not too many people knew about this gym. It was almost like a special place for those who was actually making the music, DJing the music, and stuff like that. And we need to actually talk about that more.
I think one of the reasons why the Rhodium mixtapes and Steve Yano have always been excluded, because I think it was just too underground. It was too hardcore for a lot of people, I guess, or too, you know, it was just too hard to find sometimes. But at the end of the day, it wasn't that hard to find, because word of mouth grows pretty quick. So, you know, we were able to get a hold of it one way or another. But I think maybe it was just, to me, I think it was just too hardcore, too underground for a lot of people, you know?
I think it'd been excluded for a few reasons. Because not a lot of people were advocating, you know, the importance of Steve Yano and what he was able to do, and what the Rhodium swap meet was as a gathering place for all of us DJs and MCs and people in hip hop at that time, because not enough people were really promoting that narrative. It sort of got washed over or glossed over, you know, if you will.
I think people just forget, you know, where a lot of stuff started, because of the, you know, at the moment, you know, they asking you so many questions and you know, you go back to this, not really digging that far back, because it's, you know, it's not like you writing a book, so they go only so far. But I mean, I'm gonna start mentioning it, you know, because it was a very big part of hip hop and the hip hop culture. I mean, West Coast hip hop and the hip hop culture, and that's what created N.W.A. and Eazy and a lot of other people, you know.
It's like, yeah, you know, I think he should have been included definitely in some of the things that were documentaries that were put out, because Steve Yano had a big influence on hip hop, not just West Coast hip hop. That was a big influence, but on hip hop period, because they were playing a lot of East Coast music as well. It wasn't just West Coast records you were hearing on these mixtapes. So it enlightened you to everything hip hop.
There's been a lot of documentaries on West Coast hip hop. They tend to go to the big groups, you know, the big names that were from the West Coast, and focus on Tupac, and it's understandable that they do that. And it's almost good that they didn't mention it. That way we can bust it out. We can tell the story of it. You know what I'm saying? Because Steve Yano really broke down to a lot of the ethnicity connected to hip hop. Hip hop is like that glue. But they got to go back. They've got to go and know who these groups are. You know what I'm saying? Shit, you throw on a Second to None tape right now, it stands on its own. DJ Quip songs, you know what I'm saying? That shit can play right now.
I think Steve Yano falls into another category of being, quote-unquote, one of hip-hop's minority. He's one of the minorities of hip-hop. This is a predominantly pretty run black art that we're in, and we're hip-hop's minority. I mean, you got an Asian guy that was out there in the forefront, bringing music out there to the forefront. Sometimes some of us that are doing that, sometimes people forget history. They want to rewrite history. And some of the good people that actually were pioneer, because we can't take that away from Steve Yano. He definitely was a pioneer of West Coast hip hop. He was putting out music out there when nobody else had a real outlet for it. You know what I mean? And nobody else was really doing that. You can't forget, man. You can't forget. There's as part of West Coast hip hop that some people that, like I said, that they fall between the cracks of their input and all that. But we can't let this happen, man. And that's why these documentaries and these things like this are very important, so that people know that when it comes to West Coast hip hop, there's people that actually play pivotal major roles.
I think Second to None was like the best out of everybody that ever been on the the tapes.
No bullshit.
It's the Jack the Ripper, one hitter, quitter, witter, cop the nigga real quick on the trigger. It's a celebration for one of the best, for Tony A on the cut. You about to get blessed. Now the rest could try, but they not seeing my man. And I will testify as a number one fan, I gotta rectify, cause from where I stand, I should've did this in the 80s, like the way that we planned. He been dope since Adidas and Datsuns. You think you can get him? You don't want them problems. 6'3 and the guns is yoked. Run up if you want, something getting broke. Manipulating records sounds like a band. I lure them out for a while, I high seeing them. Just step my name up for a proper introduction. I narrate the beat, the strings, and the percussion. And when I need to catch my breath, you get the main course, the star of the show, the alpha, the source. I can brag all day and I tell the truth, wouldn't you? Never mind, Tony A, show them what you could do.
Then it goes a little dark like